Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show. Now, this show does repeat on Saturdays at 8 a.m. in the morning. So feel free to get in touch. For more business tips, you can also check our New Vision website. They're both videos and different tips that you need to look through to help you improve your business. Better still, you can watch Urban TV on Rush Hour every morning at 7:15 for the latest business tips that you need moving forward. Let's talk how to make money. And the Open Day French Market offers a platform for businesses to showcase and get clients. Like the previous years, this year we focused on one Josephine Nakafero, who is a proprietor with Jose House of Creations. Now, whereas most business people out there to make money, Nakafero says she is looking at not only making money, but also conserving the environment. Now, this is her story on how to make money.
My name is Josephine Nakafero, the founder and creative designer of Jose House of Creations. Jose House of Creations is a sustainable creative brand that advocates for the environment through our eco-friendly products. So we basically make mostly fashion and craft products, but mostly African, because we love embracing being Africans through the products that we make, but most especially and most importantly, eco-friendly products. I started the Jose House of Creations because of my passion for fashion and creative design. And after retiring from my full-time job, I decided to venture into something that I'm very passionate about. I'm an African designer and I'm an African creative. So I love working with African prints and anything African, anything crafty. It's my passion, so that's why I ventured into this. And I also wanted to advocate for the environment, but not doing the talking, but doing the practical part of it. That is why we do more of the sustainability part of it. Most of our products are made from upcycled materials. So that's how we basically started this. Our way of advocating for the environment through doing or making recyclable products or upcycled products, or what we call sustainable products that are eco-friendly. Because many people do advocate for the environment, telling you the do's and the don'ts of the environment, conservation and all that. So me as a creative designer, I decided to make sure that I use products, I use materials that are friendly to the environment, but they are sustainable, that you can be able to use them. So that way we are doing the walking, but not only the talking, as much as we also talk about it, but we want to practically show you how we do this. Like, let me give you an example. We make car tires, we turn car tires into poof seats that you can sit on. We turn them into coffee tables, we turn them into chairs, and we also use old shoes. We upcycle them and we turn them into new shoes. We also use old denim or the old jeans, the ones that we use at home. You cut them and make different products. And even these other clothes, you can upcycle them, we make them, we turn them into new things, so that we add value to the waste and we give them a long lasting lifespan. Basically, my passion for the fashion and creative design is what inspired me into this, as much as I mostly focus on the international market. So locally, I don't want to say so-and-so inspired me, it's my passion. But globally, I look at the international scene and I look at the different people who are into the similar business that motivated me, not inspiring me per se, but they motivated me into going for my dream, for my passion. And that's how I started this business. And I'm still pushing through to make sure that I achieve what my goal is. The support I've been able to get from the different international organizations, like the French government, that is the French embassy in Uganda, that's why we are here to exhibit it today, and the different events that are organized by the French government through the French embassy in Uganda, and the French Institute, that is Olas Francis Kampala, they support us at different platforms. They always give us the platform to be able to exhibit and showcase our products. So we give the credit, and being an alumni, a beneficial of the French government through one of the programs that the French embassy had in Uganda, it has helped me so much and elevated me to the platform where I am today. So I give credit to them, and I am so grateful that every time there is an opportunity, a platform for us to exhibit and showcase our work, we are able to do that, and we get market. The markets that create, the platforms they create, they give us clients, because at the end of the day, we make these products, but we must have the market. We must have the people buying them for us to sustain our business. So that's how the biggest support, and also being the official design of the French Institute, that is Orleans Francaise, that's the biggest support someone can give you for you to be able to showcase your talent, something you love, but they're financially supporting you. So that's one of the biggest supports we have, and as well as the support we get from the American embassy in Uganda through the entrepreneurship programs, the funding that we get from them, it helps us to be able to widen our scope and make more products and expand our market and get more clients. That's one of our dreams, being able to sell our products. Apparently, we are selling to individuals. Like 95% of our clients are expatriates and diplomats, but we want to be able to have a stall in Paris. That's our dream, and we are working towards that, so that we are able to, not even in Paris, even in other countries, in Europe, in US, so that we are able to have a global market. We are not aiming at a local market, we are aiming at international market, because I mean, if you can buy a Gucci, I call it Gucci because sometimes in Africa we buy the fake products, but if you can afford to buy that, why shouldn't they buy our products in their own country? So that is the goal we are going for, and I'm very confident with our team at Josaus Operations we are going to achieve it. To have our products sold in Europe, in different countries, and in the US and other countries all over the world. The cost of raw materials that we use are a bit costly, as much as we're into the sustainability part of it, but there are some other products that we have to use to add into what we use, because we not only use the sustainable, upcycled materials, we also buy some other materials that we use. But the fact that they're also overtaxed, so it comes back to me, the person who's buying the material, that I'm overcharged to compensate for the person who imports these products in the country. So it makes it a little bit hard for us at our end, but we have to make sure that we strike the balance, making products that are affordable, but not also making them at a loss. We have to break free and make some profit at the end of the day. So we try our best to make sure that we juggle that too and strike a balance. Different products require different materials. So if I'm to break down different materials that we use, let's say mostly we use the African print, what we normally call ekitenge. It's one of our biggest materials that we use. We add them on other materials that we use. So we buy in rolls, let's say 6 yards or 12 yards. And depending on where you're buying from them, because our different suppliers, we have a Nigerian supplier, Ghanaian supplier, and a Congolese suppliers. So these are all importers of these materials, because I mean, the quality of materials that are being made in Uganda for the African print or the kitenge is not quite good compared to the quality of what these importers are bringing into the country. And at the end of that day, we mind about the quality of what we put out for our clients to buy. So it becomes a bit costly for us, because we have to adapt to that. As much as we want to buy Uganda, that we buy the African prints that are manufactured in Uganda, but we want to make sure that we deliver the best quality of our products to our clients. That's why we mostly focus on the imported quality materials of the African print. And we also work with our cowl shells as one of the accessories that we use. We also use rubber and different materials that we use. But they are all mostly costly, but we do not compromise on the quality of what we put out there. So we are ready to incur the cost as much as we have to add it to top it up on the quality, on the amount that we charge on our client, but we want to ensure that we give you the quality that is worth the money that we are asking from you. An estimate of the material, the money that we spend on buying the materials, let's say on African print, we buy them between 80,000, that is 6 yards, 80,100 and above. That is for the quality that we want, the quality cotton that particularly we are looking out for. That is just one piece, but you remember you have to use different materials that we use. For example, let's say these indoor sandals. We use the African print, there is a plain material that we also use the sole. So these are different materials that we use, and each one of them costs differently. And let's say this lampshade. These are indoor pendant lampshades and standout corner lampshades. So we also have to use the African print, but we also use the inside material if you look at it, and then also these metals. All these are different materials that we use to put together a product that someone is able to appreciate and love at the end of the day. So all these cost differently, and they all vary depending on our supplier, where we're buying these products or these materials. Some of the challenges that we faced are costly materials. because like I said, at Jose House of Creations we make a range of products because it's Jose House of Creations. So we want someone to be able to access anything they want. You come to a house where you are able to get a variety of products. So one of the challenges that these materials where we buy them from, they are quite costly. So at the end of the day, when you tell a client a certain amount of money that the product is costing, they are telling you the price is a little high. But for someone who appreciates, most of our expatriate clients, they appreciate the kind of art and creativity that is put into our products. So they are ready to pay the money that is worth what we are giving to them, because we do not compromise on the quality of what we are giving out. We want someone to buy a Ugandan product, but don't say this is an African made product and comparing to something that was made in Europe. So we want to make sure that we strike that balance. And the other challenge that we face, Africans or Ugandans in particular have not yet appreciated the craft and design industry. They think these are Muzungu products. We want them to be able to embrace this, that they can also achieve, they can also buy this. Like you see, these are different products that we make, like the African shirts and the hoodie jumpers, bomber jackets, all in African print. But we want a Ugandan to say, oh, this is beautiful, and they are ready to pay the money. Don't say, okay, those are for expatriates or Muzungu people who can be able to buy that. If only Ugandans can adapt to the culture of buying Uganda and building Uganda, I think we will solve most of the biggest problems that we face, and also being able to get a market. Market is not something easy to get for as long as you don't know how to reach out to your clients. So it's one of the challenges that I faced from the beginning, but right now I've been able to know who is my client and how do I reach out to my client. So with that challenge, it pushed me a bit at the early stages. I was not able to identify and also know how do I reach out to my target clientele. But apparently I learned the lesson the hard way, and I'm now able to go about it and know the channels I have to use to be able to communicate and advertise to the kind of clients that we appeal to. My business at Jose House of Creations, I learned a lot through the COVID period, that is from 2020, when it struck the world. Before, we used to think about mostly the advertisement, let's say on radio stations or TV stations. But when this happened, it pushed me out of my comfort zone of knowing that, okay, how am I going to be able to reach out to my clients? That's when I embraced the digital marketing, and that is social media, on my social media, that is Jose House of Creations on Facebook, Instagram at Jenna Cafero, Twitter at Jenna at Jose House of Creations. I used those platforms to advertise intensively for people to get to know me, because this is the time where people could not easily come to our shops or even easily order products from us, but we had to make sure that we sustain the business. Many businesses closed. I thank God that we are still standing, and through the digital marketing, it helped me to understand that actually I can use social media to advertise my business, build it, and get many clients. And right now, most of our clients, after seeing, they don't even just come on social media and comment. For as long as they see what we posted, they look out for us, because our directions are there on how to locate us up to our place, up to our shop. So COVID wasn't the best that we opted for, but it helped me, that it pushed me out of my comfort zone. And embracing the challenge, I turned the challenge into an opportunity that has elevated me to where I am today in business.
So listening to Nakafero's conversation, one thing is for sure, she clearly knows what she wants, and the prospects for her business are very clearly stated, which is something I keep saying to the different people. Last week we ran a story of a gentleman that handles a cleaning company, and some of the things he said was consistency, honesty, and quality work as key to satisfaction of the client's needs. If you're operating a business, on a daily, just ask yourself what you do different that could help you beat your competitor. Maybe these are some of the things you need to look into in 2023. Several times we say the biggest challenge for our business is financing, but I think it just goes beyond financing. Do you understand your market audience? What kind of product do you want to put out? What average age are you addressing? Don't just create things because, you know, you have the money. Do your market research well, understand the needs of your clients. If it's about quantity, then find a way of reducing it to the different sizes that they want if it is going to be in the long run. All these are basic things that we never pay attention to. But like Nakafero says, she is looking to export out of the country. Good stuff. And you can hope that she and many other young people out there trying to create something can stay focused and make headways in 2023. Time now for personal finance tips for this week. And part three in a four-part series of Personal Finance with Stephen. This week we're talking diversification of your sources of income. Personal finance.
Diversification of income means that you have different or various sources of income and you don't have to rely on only one. One source could be your own business. Sometimes it looks exciting, but it isn't. Yeah, I've lost a business before because two to three top customers had trouble in their businesses and they stopped sending purchase orders. So I mean, the remaining ones could no longer support the business. Those two were making up 80% of her income. So you really need to earn from various places. Single income can be just job. It doesn't matter whether you're the CEO. If it's one source, it's one source, and it's bad. Yeah, it is not secure, however much it may look secure. In our time today, we see a lot of insurance companies, lots of people talking about insurance. It is good that there is awareness, but insurance is not something new. When this verse was written in the Bible, they were talking about insurance. They talk about disaster coming upon the land. Now, if God would care to let us know that we need insurance, would care to let us know that, you know what, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Don't invest in one place, however big it is. Do not put your eggs in one basket. I mean, why then now would you say, I've got at the top of the company, I am now the boss, so I'm okay. I have medical insurance at the workplace, my children are covered, I am covered. But the thing is, that medical insurance, that job position does not last forever. In fact, the employment contract usually puts it clear that if you are incapacitated, if you can no longer work because of illness or anything, then your contract gets terminated. When your contract gets terminated, you will not have that medical insurance. Even if the company was paying school fees for your children, it will no longer be doing so. So there is insurance that is absolute, and that is diversifying your income sources. The insurance that is called insurance in our time, the medical, I mean, all these, well, I'll say even the school fees, and there's insurance called life insurance, you know, all of that. I would like to put it out clearly that they are very good, but they are the basic. They are like the most basic. Yeah, I want to call them painkillers. I want to call them something like, you know, if you get knocked, some people like to say that you get knocked by a bullion van, by a car that's carrying money. So you're surely going to be compensated well. But question is, if you break your leg and you're compensated, what gain is it? There isn't much. Yeah, so that insurance is good, but it is the basic. Whereas the insurance that we're told about in the Book of the Wise is one that will, even if you die, the people you live will have it, and they'll have enough. They'll have things that are still growing. I mean, if you have investments, the investments are not necessarily going to die, when you die. So maybe the question that many viewers may want to ask is that how do I diversify my income? And I want to take you back to a previous show where we talked about increasing your income, and I highlighted some things. One thing that I want to take you back to is equipping yourself with as much knowledge as possible, because it is from that knowledge that you are going to be able to make wise decisions to diversify your income. I want to start with the basic. The basic one is you need two different types of investments. Number one is you need what I call a long-term fixed investment. Long-term fixed investments are these most common ones, the houses, the land, those ones. They are long-term, you know? They are long-term assets and they are fixed. You can also call them illiquid because you cannot easily turn them into money without them losing value. If you want to sell quickly, then you are going to have to cut the price and sell. If it was worth 100 million and you want to sell quickly, someone says, I have 70 million cash, then they take it. Yeah? Now, you find that you invested, now supposing you invested 70 million, the value has reached 100 million, then you need money quickly. And someone says, I'm giving you 70. Was the effort worth it? It definitely wasn't. So what you need to do is to have another kind of investment. I call it petty cash investment. You know, in the communities where we live, many people that run canteens, small shops, appear to be doing well. The reason is very simple. It is because they have cash flow.
Well, so Stephen there talks about how important it is to have more than one source of finance, of income into your daily life. Of course, one will ask, I'm struggling to get one job, and you're telling us to have an option for making money. If you can, it's important to have more than one source of income so that in case one backfires, you can, you know, cover up from the other. If you need to pay some bills, you can, you know, account, transfer some money from the other business rather than borrowing and pay. So it's important in this 2023 for you to just look at how you can better yourself. Create an alternative source of income for your business. It might be smaller than the main one, but it's better then, because you are then sure that you can still cover up moving forward. Let's talk Forex now and the money market report for this week. And the shilling remained relatively strong against the dollar, through the start of the week. And here now is what you can expect for the rest of the week. So there you have it. The fuel prices seem to continue going down. What's interesting is that diesel keeps going up and petrol is going down. It doesn't matter for now. At least there is some kind of relief for most people. Not just those that drive, but even the business community. Because like I keep saying, this trickles down to the final man. If the fuel prices are high, the guys transporting the produce increase the money, the business guys equally, or the traders increase their charges, and then the final customer buys things at a relatively higher price. So with the fuel prices, you know, constantly reducing, we can hope that it can actually go back to the 4,000 mark. I don't know when, but yeah, there could be hope, yeah? Now, before we go, let's have the business quote for this week. And it says, your most unhappy customers are your greatest source of learning. Your most unhappy customers are your greatest source of learning. That is by Bill Gates. How many times do you sit down with your clients and listen to their complaints? Or are you the type that when someone complains, you throw them out and tell them, fine, thanks for doing business, never come back again? The feedback from clients who support your business, whether you believe it or not, because when they tell you some of the things that they think you need to improve on, not everything they say is right, okay? But you need to sit down and evaluate them and see if they make business sense. And if they do, then you might have to implement them, because that is the only way you can grow your clientele base, but also make some money. 2023 is still fresh. Make that money. But I keep saying, save it for the future. My name is Simon. I'll see you soon. Thanks for watching. Take care of yourselves. Good night. Bye-bye.